30, I take, you know, nothing on your back. Big lesson learned. So from 2001 to 2003, we went through trial by fire. The only thing that kept us going in that time, I think, was just some kind of innate faith, an innate confidence and faith that we are onto something. We did look at numbers, and I'll talk about that a little later. But we had a lot of confidence, me and these two other guys who became co-founders during this period because they took big cuts. I took 100% cut in salary for 2 years. I could, actually closer to 18 months, not full 2 years. I could because I had a working wife. My two of my colleagues took 70% and 30% cuts. And for that, I said, you'll get back equity. And we all knew at that time the equity is just paper right now. And thankfully, it worked out. But at that point of time, you need someone to bounce your ideas off. You need someone to tell you that you're probably thinking in the right direction. And you need much more than numbers and graphs, which seem to, you know, they'll probably intersect after 2 years or 3 years and you'll break even. You need much more than that because every day you actually have to confront the thing. And the question is in your head all the time, like, am I doing the right thing or am I being just completely stupid and stubborn, and should I just go back to a working life? And that happens in every journey I've heard of entrepreneurship in India. And that's really important for each one of you to keep in mind. When colleagues of mine quit, or when I'm talking to younger entrepreneurs through TIE, which is a body for young entrepreneurs where we mentor young entrepreneurs, the Indus entrepreneurship, I always tell them one thing. I have colleagues who come to me and they say, we want to quit. And I say, why? And they say, well, we want to become an entrepreneur. And I really can't say no. I can stop them from joining anywhere else and I'll do. But when they say, listen, we really want to turn entrepreneur, how can you say no? You try to give them an entrepreneurial role. And I say, they say, give me one piece of advice as I'm leaving. What should I keep in mind? And it's been consistent over the last 5 years. I tell each person only one thing. Don't look in the rearview mirror for 4 to 5 years. In India, I don't believe you'll see the semblance of a business even in 4 to 5 years. Maybe things are changing. Maybe we're getting a little bit more, the ecosystem's getting more fertile. Maybe we're getting somewhere closer to Silicon Valley. But I just came back from China last week and I can tell you we are so far away. We are light years away from China. It'll happen, but it's a different planet right now. The statistics are staggering. There's a food delivery company called Meituan, which is 6 years old, merged with another company called Dianping. They deliver 15 million meals a day, 1.5 million meals a day. They manage 500,000 guys, riders. And I'm saying, like, are you serious? Like 15 million? And they are growing 200%. So the scale, what's happening in China is mind-boggling. It's numbing. Doesn't mean it won't happen here. It will happen here, and we need to be ready. But when and if you turn entrepreneurs, please hold the faith. 3, 4, 5, minimum 3 to even see this, you know, the shoot emerging from the ground or green shoots emerging, and 4, 5 years to know if you've really put in enough. I believe the best businesses, some of the best businesses have not seen light of day because some entrepreneur gave up too early. Some entrepreneur just got the chills and said, what am I doing? I have a degree from IIM Ahmedabad. I could be earning big bucks right now. My colleagues are in banks and in consulting and in FMCG. Each one is making no less than 20, 30, 40 lakhs, crores or whatever. What the hell am I doing? And someone probably didn't have tick. This one is couldn't be more relevant anywhere else than in the hallowed portals of Wimby. Wimby is still popular, still used? Yeah, okay. So I think as you turn entrepreneur and if you've graduated out of this amazing place, you really have a huge advantage, but it can be a double-edged sword. Before you realize it, this big advantage, which is an insurance policy, I can assure you till the age of maybe 40, even 45 in this country, you will waive this degree and the doors will open. There is something about that word. I can't say this anywhere else. I can only say it at IIM Ahmedabad and maybe a few IITs. That's true. Yeah, we should, absolutely. There is something those four letters do to people on the other side. Even now when we hire, and we've hired a few guys from IIM-A, and I'm also very clear that we don't want to hire freshers from IIM-A because they're too flighty, but I'm quite happy after they've seen the world, come back after 3 or 4, 5 years, and they've figured out, like, listen, this is what I want to do. Maybe that's the right time to get them. but it does something to recruiters. And that's great. You know, you worked very hard to get in here, and that will always be the case. But it can become a double-edged sword. Before you realize it, it can end up becoming a noose. And that's when you get into that trap, which is, what are the 179 other peers? In our case, we had 180. I think you have 360. What are my 359 other peers doing while I'm waging this war against the world, trying to build the next Bitcoin technology, which will shake the world? Right? You've got this awesome idea, and it's, you can't see the green shoots because it's 1 year, it's 2 year. You're putting everything into it. You're truly, truly working 18 hours a day. You're truly working Saturdays and Sundays. That's what it takes. And you're saying, what am I doing? And I'm not taking anything out. Maybe you'll get funded up front. That's fine. That money will start running out. You'll spend so much time trying to raise more money. And it'll seem like darkness. There's no light at the end of the tunnel. That's when this thing can play wicked games with your mind. And this degree, because all your other batchmates have the same degree, and 90% of them or 80% of them or whatever the percentage is, are in great corporate jobs and obviously doing really well on Wall Street, in Hong Kong, in Singapore, in Bombay, in Delhi, whatever, they're rocking it, right? And you can just see this guy or this gal is cruising, and thanks to social media, it gets rubbed in even more because you're seeing the holiday in the south of France and you're saying, oh yeah, right, and then Wimbledon pictures are coming up and it's so wrong, right? But folks, if you want to be an entrepreneur, there is no shortcut. And there should not be a shortcut. Because when you will look back after 10 years, or 8, or 6, I hope for you guys, and you will feel so proud about the toughest times. Even today, I can tell you without a doubt, the best time of our life was 2001 to 2003, when we had nothing. We worked in a tiny mezzanine, we shrunk to a mezzanine. If I raised my hands, I touched the ceiling. And if I swung them this way and I rocked a little bit, I could touch both sides. We were a long railway compartment of a mezzanine. It was next to a warehouse for Wipro soap and oil, their original business. It stank. Most of the time, it really stank. It was a stinky place. And there was a... Any of you know what's a dharamkanta? Okay. And there was a dharamkanta right under it for the... It was so crazy. So one day, my co-founder... when the guard came running up and says, sir, aapka gaadi lag gaya. He says, kya hua? He says, wo truck maar ke chala gaya. This guy, his entire boot had gone because one of these trucks had just knocked the whole boot off. And so it was a really place in the boonies at 10 rupees a square foot, Okhla phase one, the cheapest possible real estate you can get, industrial park, probably in the country. And that's what the kind of thing you got to do. And you're wondering, what are we doing? Is this right? Is this wrong? But those were the best days. So it should not be easy. Do not fall to the trap stuff. There's a fine line, excuse me. There's a fine line between stubbornness and perseverance. And the irony is that you will probably only know which one it was later in the day. It's true. When you're in the moment, there is nothing but stubbornness. You can say, I'm persevering. I look back, there were at least three incidents where I should have given up much earlier in my life. But I could not tell because I'm in the moment. I'm living that moment. I'm right there. In AMF bowling, I wasted 2 years of my life. I can say today, okay, no regrets. But perhaps I should have been practical and I should have said, I should move on. But then on the flip side, we came close to selling the company at least twice because they were such tough times. One was during that phase, 2001 to 2003. We were meeting two companies, and I guess we can talk about them now. There was a company called Sendent, the name has changed, and they were very keen to buy us, and there was a company called Zuji, which was Travelocity's subsidiary in Southeast Asia, and both were pretty keen, I think, to buy the company. And I went to meet them, and I told both my colleagues out there, and we had reached the end. You know, really, as they say, you're burning on both sides, you reached the end, you went back home, you know, your wife gave you that look like, aage phir. And two of us were married. We felt that way. The third guy wanted to get married, and his in-laws would always look at him and say, it was really bad. So I told Sachin and Keyur both. Keyur Joshi is actually from Ahmedabad, and I should have told him, he would have probably joined. And I told Sachin and Keyur that I'm going to go have this discussion with them. And guys, what's the price that we're going to settle on? So I told them, if we get $10 million at that time, I think we should sell. We owned between us, I think we owned 55% of the company, and then 45% were angels. It was a lot of money in 2002. And we said, that will buy us respectability. Okay, you'll be able to get married, and you know, our wives will smile again. Hamare ghar mein bhi fir chirag jalega, and all that bullshit. So, and both these guys said, yeah, 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 that's a lot. One of them, Sachin, took out calculator and was calculating. And I said, yaar, utna hi hai. Matlab, we know how to multiply that, right? It hasn't changed. That time it was 4.8. Now it's 6.5. That time it was 48. So you multiplied by 4.8 million to dollar. Simple way you got that. So I said, theek hai, 10 million. These guys, one of them, was stuck at 5. And I can't tell you how happy I was to leave that restaurant. If all of you who know Delhi near Aurobindo Mark, there's a restaurant called Waves, IIT Gate, just next to the side of IIT Delhi Gate. And they didn't budge beyond 5, and maybe they would have gone to 6. I was so relieved. And I only realized later I actually did not want to sell at all. And really, you didn't want to, but had they said 10, I'd promised these guys. I think one of them came with me for one of the meetings. At the second meeting, they had called us to Hong Kong. That's another story where, again, there was a gap. And we were so relieved coming back saying, actually, the only thing we wanted to know is, will you pay for our journey? That was the main thing. And they said, we'll pay for one. We said, but we are three and we will come together. So, and we'll fly economy, we get cheap tickets, we are in travel business, blah, blah, blah. So we managed to do it in one. Travel agents can do all these things. And again, we were so happy we came that close. And Flipkart, and Sachin Bansal has admitted this to me privately, and I don't know if he'll feel, I think he's okay about it. They came this close to selling the company for 10 million bucks. They went and gave their word, Flipkart. They're probably the most valuable startup today, and it's a really great company, I believe. They went, they gave their word to someone. They were also going through exactly the same terrible times, tough times, nothing happening. And they came back, and he hasn't told me who, but they had like a consultant, a mentor. And he says, unhone hame itni pitai ki, itni galiyan sunai hindi mein, bata nahi sakta. But we said, what have you guys done? You cannot sell this company. Right now, you're going to build something amazing. They're only selling books at that time. So the point I'm just trying to make is, it'll seem bleak, it'll seem crazy. I would much rather you err on the other side. So what if you give it one more year or six months more? It's a marathon. It's not a sprint. It might be a series or sprint, but life or entrepreneurship is clearly a marathon. And it's immaterial today for me, whether it took me 8 years to list our company or 12, whether I started in 2000 or like Sanjeev started in 1997 and he's built probably, I think, one of the finest companies in India. Or someone started in 2003, how does it matter in the end of the day? It's immaterial. So therefore, always, I would say, err on the side of saying I'm persevering. Later, you'll figure out if you were stubborn or not. But hang in there. Don't quit till it sapped every iota of your self-confidence, strength, sweat, tears, blood, everything. When you're completely ravaged and completely wrecked and you have nothing else left to give, go see Rocky 3 and then come back once again. So see that there. Yeah. So this is a really cool thing that we would do. So during these tough days in Okhla phase one, when we sat at the end of this railway bogey, and when three of us swiveled around, our knees would touch each other. I'm not kidding. We were that tight and that close. And it was a little uneasy feeling if you don't like male contact of that order, but it did. So, and we had, but we still had a little TV which was up there because we had to watch cricket, of course. And all through the night, we took calls from the US on our 1-800-INDIA-10 number. And we sold tickets. And that's what we did all night long. When things got very tough, clearly, you can't stop thoughts, right? If anyone out here has mastered, not thinking or letting thoughts come in for more than a couple of minutes, then that's significant. That's meditation to another level. It's very, very hard because the more you say no thoughts, the more thoughts come in. We all know that. So it would show on our face and then, people, kind of the rest of the team would pick up what's going on, etc. So one day we made a rule. I think it was my idea and someone enunciated very well that either we are in or we are not for the whole month. So once we are in, we'll be in for a month. And we will not through the whole month question ourselves on what are we doing. And then at the end of the month, we'll take stock. We obviously looked at numbers every day. We looked at conversion by shift. Conversion by individual guy taking a call within his bar. We're creatures of numbers, of course. But we will not take a call till the whole month is over. And end of month, obviously, most of these discussions were done over a a cheap bottle of alcohol on the single guy's terrace, always on KU's terrace because he was single, and we had this thing, and we would have this thing. Are we in for one more month? And then we were in for a month. I tell you, this silly, stupid ritual kept us going for at least a good part of a year. 8-9 months, it kept us going. Because instead of 8-9 months being 240 or 270 days, they actually became discrete 8-9 months. And we had each other, and that's why it really helps, because you promised, you know, when we want to, any of you have tried to quit smoking, so you go and tell the world, because I want to quit, and also that your friends will say, nahi pina, and that kind of thing. So there's pressure, so you've told each other, we will not do this. And so it really helped, and it's tided us through. It tided us through, I think, a tough time. So we call that discipline and depression, but I think that's really, really relevant when you're going through the tough time. You need your true north. You need someone to latch on to. You need to cry your woes, but you also need to be, when you're in, you need to be disciplined. As they say, for a sportsman, again, the biggest gift you have for a sportsman at the highest level is zero memory. So what they say is, especially, I don't play golf, but I heard this from actually a shooter. I heard Hina Sidhu speak the other day, our shooting champion, at a small event, an investors conference. And I was asking, I said, so Hina, there was Hina and Viren Rasquena, the Indian ex-hockey captain, both awesome guys. And I was saying, Hina, like, what is it about this sport? Like, and she was describing it, it's 10 meters away, 30 feet away. And she says, picture that, it's the tip of a ball pen. And that tip of the ball pen is actually divided into 9. And that's how that is the bullseye, and that's the scoring. So if you've had a bad shot and you're going back and you're doing that shot again, all you need is a little tremor to start anywhere, here, there, whatever, to completely take you off. So the ultimate thing is to have zero memory of your last shot. And I remember reading this of Tiger Woods also somewhere. He said the same thing. He says no memory. Because if you have memory, then you'll always get into that trap. And this is also very similar. So if you're going through a tough phase, you've had a tough month, you've had a bad time, say we're going to start all over again. We're going to start. And that's how you get out of bad form. So if you're in bad form, the only way you get out of it is not by wallowing in the bad form, but by believing that you can actually play much better. You're just going through a bad patch. So everyone out here now knows big data, and we are all doing a lot of stuff in it, I'm sure. Clearly, it's the future. Clearly, data sciences has moved to the next level. Artificial intelligence, I mean, now it doesn't take a genius. 3 years ago, people said it, and they said, really, wo kya hota hai and all. It's all happening. We have chatbots. We have now 2 chatbots on our post-sale service. 20% of all post-sale queries are getting answered by chatbots, and people don't know. One of them is called Dinah, one's called Robin, and we're doing various different things with it. But I'm not the best guy. Our CTO is the best guy to talk about that. But it's fascinating what can happen with a learning system. But I think you've got to be thinking about big data in very micro packets long, long back. One of the big reasons we survived was definitely belief, faith. But the right side, no, the left side brain, whichever is the non-creative side, that has to be all about numbers. You have to be very, very clear on when are you going to be able to break even when you have no cash. You have to know it in your sleep. How many months do you have to burn? And it's a term people use, like how many months do you have to burn out, to flame out, you're over. And then you've got to leave 6 months. Now, when you get into that whole thing and you start raising funds, keep a year comfort and cushion. Today, you know, the company is doing well, but we could raise money some time back. I went and raised $330 million because I know there's mayhem in the market, because there's Chinese money coming in and there are guys trying crazy things. You've got to do all of that. So you've got to have both sides working in tandem. There's one side of you which is very clinical, number-driven, and there is zero emotion out there. And then that is balanced out almost by the side where the passion comes in. And they don't work in tandem. They're asynchronous, but you need both. To take decisions, you will take decisions. All the small linear decisions will be taken based on fact and science. All the non-linear, strategic, new thing decisions are based on gut. They are not based on fact. Because otherwise, like they say, in 1904, if you asked Henry Ford said, if I ask the people what they wanted, they'll say a faster horse carriage, because they didn't know a car exists. So if you're thinking of doing something fundamentally different with the business, there's no data, and you can't even look out, because India 2.0, the next 100 million, No country has probably seen that kind of population so young and come into the workforce all at once, and that's going to happen here in a staggering way, and no one has solutions for them. Is it a chat-based solution? Is it a voice-to-text chat-based solution? Is it something totally different? Will there be UIs? We are questioning ourselves, will there be UIs in the apps going forward? Why should there be a UI? Why can't it be a chat? Why are we wasting so much time with a user interface and very cool and very sexy front ends, et cetera? It might just go away. The next 100, 200 million people couldn't care less. They're actually intimidated by that UI, but they're not intimidated right now with this chat bubble. And maybe, you know, Alexa at Amazon or Siri at Apple is telling us something which we're not hearing. And think about it, if that could be made to understand Bhojpuri and Bihari and Kannada at the same time and translate it and talk to your booking engine and you could throw out. And I'm sure many of you have thought about those things. We do, and those are real business solutions. Of course, the reality is ideas and strategy do get eaten for breakfast by execution. And we can talk about that later, but you still have to have bright ideas. The beauty of the internet business is you can iterate, you can experiment very, very quickly. You can do really quick stuff. Once you build a framework called an AB framework, you can put out tiny experiments. Gone are the days, all the FMCG guys, I remember what Hindustan Levers would do and Colgate would do, and you know, they said, we're going to launch a product in, new product in Kakinada, and we're going to do this in Chandigarh was a favorite, and Pune was a favorite, and maybe Vizag. There were these three, four cities at every tier which were favorites. And then they would take months and months and months to gather feedback, and then they'll roll in the feedback, and they say, okay, and it would take probably a year to launch a product. Today, the beauty on the internet is you can experiment with a change, ceteris paribus, and that's the beauty, keeping everything constant. You can expose 1% of your traffic, random traffic, 1%, to a change you make in pricing, in UX, in fundamental different way of buying. If tomorrow I make this chat-based way, I'll expose 1% of people to it. And if it's positive, after 2 weeks, we'll ratchet that up to 5%, then to 10, and then you do load testing. And finally, you take the leap from 50 to 100. Some of you know this, but I can't tell you the boon it is to that business. So in our business, we are saying we like something. A product manager says, I think this is going to work. So we'll say, what have you based it on? And these are our discussions. He says, I did a consumer lab, because now he knows the questions I'm going to ask, someone's going to ask. I've spoken to 20 consumers, 30 consumers. This is all my research. This is okay, go do it. Go build this. These are the resources for it. You need one UX person, two engineers, one QA guy. This is your pod. This is your team. Go do it. Do it in a sprint. Do it. Have it out in 1.5, 2 months. Test it and come back with the results. It's that easy. So it's actually... But that, why I put this here is, that's the philosophy to the business today. That's what almost all businesses are doing. I'm not sure if you're aware, but all big funds today in the world, the biggest funds in the world, in the public market, are being threatened by index funds, by computers. They're saying computers are making better decisions possibly than these very highly paid fund managers. Do we need them at all? So the fintech is actually disrupting the very guys who invested behind fintech. Who's running? Who's the timekeeper? Go on. Peaceful. Okay, good. Thank you, Aman. So we launched in India in 2000 and in US market together. There were 19 other travel websites at that time, or maybe 20 other, and there was Net2Travel, Travelanza, Travelmart India, Travel Genie, you name it, anything to do with travel, anything to do with Safar, Yevo, everything was there. And they were funded by good guys like ICICI in those heydays. Everyone was well funded, like 2 million, 3 million, 5 million. And each one of them flamed out. Not one of them existed beyond 2003, 2004. Yatra was actually launched in 2005. They weren't there in that crazy early era. And the only mistake each of those companies made, some of them were actually better. We hired some guys from there. I love hiring entrepreneurs who have actually burnt their hands, but are quite happy to say, listen, I learned a lot and I want to put this thing. I think they're awesome guys to hire because they have no fear. And all of them made one mistake, which is they labored on in the Indian market. They kept saying, we are going to make this market work by putting in more money. Sometimes markets aren't ready. And there's that much you can do, including discounting, to open up a market. We've been trying to open up the hotel market in India since 2006, 2007. And finally, I can say the last 2 years now, people have started booking hotels online, but in a small way. Air tickets, 60% of all air tickets in the country domestic are bought online, 60%. We have a very large market share in that market. Hotels, only about 10-12% are bought online. Despite the crazy discounts, you see what's going on. And the reason is there's so many more dimensions to a hotel booking. And don't think a five-star or a four-star chain. Think about a property for 1,800, 2,000. When you go to Diu and you want to, you know, skimp on money, when you go to Goa and you don't want to splurge a lot of money, an unknown place, there are too many dimensions. Indians want to show up and then they want to negotiate across the counter. And that's why we did that ad. Actually, each one of our ads with our current brand ambassadors, Ranveer and Alia, were based on customer insight, number one, two, three. Number one was Indians believe if they show up and they negotiate across the counter, and this is only Indian, no other nationality in the world I've learned does this. They go hotel to hotel. They get out of the car, they go hotel to hotel, and they negotiate in three different hotels. They see the rooms, and they are actually negotiating like they're buying pyaaz tamatar and saying, kamra sasta milega. And therefore, we had Ricky saying, I want my discount. And this geek who walks in with our app, I hope you saw that ad, says he gets the discount because we're just trying to change that mindset. So the market has to be right at some level. And actually, the next point is pretty linked to this. And today, I got into Ahmedabad early, and I was just sharing with Professor and Ujwal and Umang. I visited about 17 small hotels today. Two-star, three-star, no four-star. I did check into a decent place, finally. I thought I'll actually stay in a competitor's hotel, but then someone said, tomorrow, if your name is recognized, someone will be tweeting, Deep Kalra uses Oyo. So I said, not a nice thought. So I changed that. So I went to many Oyos, but I did not check in. But I learned a lot of things. And this is part of a drive we have, go-to-market drive. We have re-institutionalized it because somewhere along the way, all of us, starting with me, the moment you get senior, etc., you start saying, yeah, the market flunks will go and do the work. It'll come back, the marketing agency will package it, and I'll see the highlight, executive summary. That executive summary is damn dangerous. Because while it prepares you enough to sound knowledgeable, executive summaries don't give you customer insights. Customer insights only and only come firsthand. They get lost in translation. And we all did this. I remember the market research project we had here was for the first supermarket to open in Ahmedabad in 91. By a Mr. Rauji, Rauji's supermarket. I don't even know if it's there now. Tiny little thing, like it was like much, much smaller than some of the Ahmedabadis would know. It was a tiny thing, and we had a market research to do out of it. And five of us, with a lot of enthusiasm, karenge, knocked on doors, got slammed, did this, spoke to some ladies, couldn't. Finally, after we finished, I think 20%, we said, yes, significant statistical set hai. 20% hai, baki extrapolate karte hain. So we sat under a nice tree, we had chai, and we fudged what we shouldn't have fudged. But we only got the insight for 20%, and we obviously did something wrong. And I told the guys, so the top 100 guys in the company have been mandated, one day in the month is go-to-market month. And it's a weekday, and go ahead on a weekday and do it. But if you don't, the last day of this month is a Saturday. You will be out on a Saturday or a Sunday, or latest on 2nd October doing market research. So you jolly well do it. And I'm filing in my reports late night today so as to just egg people on. Half have done it, half haven't. But irrespective, the amount I learned in those visits is unbelievable. And the amount I learn every time I talk to a real consumer, sometimes I share halfway through the conversation I'm with MakeMyTrip. On planes, I just like go out of the way to talk to my passengers on the side. Today I was bribing him with smoked almonds. Kuch aur batado, trying to this thing. But it's amazing the learnings you get if you're willing to ask. But real customers, getting a theoretical set never works. You've got to be in the moment. They will tell you why they make this choice and why they don't make this choice. And I'd say just never relegate, never delegate market research beyond a certain level. You can't do everything. Always ensure you're doing something, whether it's half a day or one day, no matter what position you reach. By the way, our name, Make My Trip, came pretty much out of a lot of people have asked me, how did you name it Make My Trip? And by and large, you know, it brings a smile to people's faces. And of course, many of my friends teased me about Take My Trip and Make My Trip. And we've gone through all of that. There was a time I even took takemytrip.com. I kept it. I said, koi aur le lega. But we had five or six names. We had Travel Raja. We had Make My Trip. We had three of Travel Play. We had about five names we had shortlisted. And we made the names ourselves. And five of us went to the busiest five markets in Delhi, and we stood outside there for two hours, and we showed people all five names, and we said, which one do you like on cards? That's it. And this, that was overwhelmingly all five, we all came back. I was one of them, these two guys I mentioned, and two other guys. Everyone came back with the same result. They said people, it made people smile. A couple of them had trouble pronouncing it. Now, we didn't probably do it beyond Delhi, but, you know, market research has its thing. If we had given it to an agency, it might have been a different result. Who knows? Okay, we have a few more interesting slides. So the most valuable player on your team very often can end up being a pita. Anyone knows what a pita is? Pain in the, right? Yeah, so it's a pain in the wrong place. And, but the reality is you need that pita. That pita is actually your most valuable player because he or she is the person who will get under your skin, will irritate you because they will ask you the toughest, the most awkward questions at the toughest of times. In front of your board, sometimes if you're the kind of company that allows people, you know, management and board and to have group sessions, or in front of your leadership team, they will ask you questions that will make you look silly. I've had it happen to me not once, multiple times. And now I've become again thick-skinned about it. But the first time was very hard. I had spent the whole weekend making a plan on why after the US, we should launch in Australia before UK for various reasons for our NRI market. And I came and I presented it Monday. This was already after we were in India, I think 2005, 2006. And I said, this is what we should do. And this guy heard me out, and everyone heard me out, and they said, boss, kaam karke aaye hai, must show some respect. And this guy said, I think it's the dumbest idea I've heard, quote unquote. And I was like, excuse me? And he said, I think it's the dumbest idea I've heard because Australia is ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta, and we are not seeing under our nose, India's ready, and 2005 LCCs had started. We should be launching in India now. We are wasting. We are already 6 months late, et cetera, et cetera. It took me a bit. I did go red in the face. I got angry. And then I realized, obviously, the guy was right, and I took his advice. After that, I promised myself that, A, I'll publicly apologize that I'm wrong, and it's perfectly okay. The message it sends out to your team. So when you start up your companies or you're the big shot in the company you join, the message it sent out to the rest of the team is unbelievable. People say you can say the right thing and not get into trouble for it. And it really encourages people to say, I'm going to challenge what you're saying. And actually, that's what you want. You want challengers in your team. You don't want yes men. You don't want people who think like you and nod. If you say it's a great idea, they say it's a great idea. Bad news, you want the person who's going to challenge you on fact. Sometimes you will have to obviously say, okay, don't make this a habit, right? Like, sometimes I have to look good. But it's really important to have these people. They'll irritate you, but I've realized you want to keep them. They are your best friends at work. As companies grow up, as companies mature, there's a very painful reality which comes, which is that not every manager and not every leader grows apace with the company. And it's sad because sometimes you've got to supersede some of your very, very close guys who were in the founding years and very senior guys with talent from outside. It's very painful. It's not only painful for the person who gets superseded. I can tell you it's very painful to do, especially if that person's been with you through thick and thin. But that is where I think the value of an independent, strong board comes in, having independent board members or mentors. So Sanjeev, again from here, Sanjeev Bikchandani, he's been one of those guys who I can go to for advice anytime, and he will always tell me zero bias. He has no bias. He's still an advisor in the company. No bias. He'll say the right thing, what he believes in. It may not be technically correct, but he'll say, listen, remove yourself from the situation. And I'm not your friend when I'm giving you this advice. I'm the friend of the company. This is right for the company. And it's strange, but sometimes even if you're the founder of a company, what is right for you may not actually be the same what's right for the company. It's very weird. There are times when you'll have these things come in. Personal biases will come in. You want to protect people. I was told repeatedly by my board in 2007, 2008, that we need to replace a very senior person or remove him from the job and get another world-class talent into that job. And I resisted it for three quarters. I said, no, it's a bad timing. He's a great guy. Is this? Because that's my natural thing. Not at all. He's a great guy. I couldn't get myself around to talking to him. And finally, thanks to Sanjeev, I did. And it turned everything. It turned our P&L, we turned profitable, we got on our way to profit to listing. So it, you need to have at least one or two friends who'll give you the unadulterated truth, including when it says that, buddy, even your time's up. So I think each one of us needs to know our best before date. It's very hard to say it's true for us. And you've got to have someone you can go to and ask a question as fundamental and as frightening as, do you think I'm still the right guy to take this company forward? I've got two guys like this, actually a guy and a lady. Irina Vittal, again, batch of 89 from IIM Calcutta. Unbelievable lady, unbelievable. She's like an executive coach. I think I have a third also. Another 20 years senior from here, Dhruv Prakash. He's been an executive coach for us. He's unbelievable. So I have at least three people I can go to and ask them without a bias, this is what's going on. Do you think I'm still the right guy? And I do that from time to time. And it's very important. And they'll say, why are you, thinking of something? I said, no, I just want to make sure. And that actually helped me make changes in the management team. What all my co-founder Rajesh manages today is basis of the feedback you get, because you look at yourself in the mirror and, you know, you'll always look good to yourself, but you're not going to see the chinks in the armor. Founderitis is a term I've coined, but it's basically a disease when founders start believing that they are the last word and they are the only ones. They are firstly the elixir for all ideas in the company. They are the gospel truth, and they will always decide what's right or wrong. Shockingly, surprisingly, there are many companies like this in India even today. I can tell you they will not scale beyond a certain level. Again, if you're Steve Jobs, you might. Steve Jobs comes around once in a billion years, maybe, one in a billion. I think some of these companies, the key man risk is too high, not because something will happen to that person, because no one person can always be right all the time. You've got to have a culture where people can challenge each other and refine decisions. And the moment you start believing this, it's the beginning of the end for any company. We've seen it happen in two of our largest, most valuable companies in India. And I think it's painful for everyone to see what's happened around. We can talk about it in Q&A or later, but it's very, very painful to see what's happening. And that can happen to the biggest companies. Wealth creation's happening, all of that. It could be a byproduct, but it's very nice to tie these in. And just a couple of two slides to go, but I do believe it sounds philosophical, but I do believe that the more you focus on an exit, the further away it will go. I know enough people who have built their companies to sell it, and they never got sold for anything decent. Never. Because you start focusing on the wrong thing. You start focusing on company packaging and valuation, not on the reason for being. The raison d'etre for any company to be, yes, you can say, is to make money. That's not the raison d'etre. That's a byproduct. The raison d'etre is to solve a customer pain point, is to solve a customer problem, and hopefully to delight customers. If you can do that consistently, and I don't think we are there at consistency, I think we're 6 on 10 today. Good news is we have a long way to go. But if you can do that consistently, like an Amazon, like an Apple, like a Haldiram, like an Indigo, I think these are great companies, and I love the Indian examples who do it fairly consistently all the time. If you can do it consistently, you will realize the real flywheel, the real virtuous cycle getting built in. And that's the beauty. And then you will get the exit. We never dreamt of an IPO till 6 months before in a meeting when two board members said, guys, you guys should start thinking about listing. And someone asked me later, do you want to list or do you want to sell? And I said, why would we ever sell? I mean, that's bizarre, right? I had those two incidents and we want to create something we've just started. And that's very important. So it's a huge decision which will come to you at some point of time when you grow your company. Do you want to list or do you want to sell? When you go public, it is only base camp of Everest. That's all it is. It is just a stage. You reach a stage, you can take a little bit of money off the table. But the last guy holding the can is the entrepreneur or the entrepreneurial team, I can tell you. Investors can get out, but entrepreneurs don't. You take the company forward, but you have public funds. You have a currency with which you can trade. You can buy and sell companies overseas. You can do a lot of stuff when you're public. It's awesome. The biggest thing you can do is, like I said, you can issue stock, and you can issue stock to everyone. With the coolest story we had, the nicest story ever, is when our runner boy, Arif Khan from Bulandshahr, he had some stock we had given him in our wisdom long back, and he bought a house back in Bulandshahr with his RSUs. So that was an awesome one, yeah. And I do believe there's no such thing as luck. Right place, right time, maybe. I think luck is, it's all probability. If the probability of success is 10%, please make sure you knock on 10 doors, one will open. If you knock on 3 doors, the chances of a door opening are less than 1, as we all know. Itna math sabko yahan aata hai. So there's nothing else to it. All of this other stuff, right place, right time, is there. Lage rao is there. Perseverance is there. But don't think luck, this thing, no. Just try hard enough, experiment hard enough for those of you who want to turn entrepreneurs. So that's pretty much it.